Hey there, and welcome to the Chain Rules Talk. My name is Miha Zgubič, and I'm a research software engineer at Invenia Labs. Invenia loves Julia. We use machine learning to optimize the electricity grids, and if you want more Julia and less emissions, you should come and join us. When I joined Invenia about a year ago, Chain Rules was already a relatively mature project built by the open source community. So the disclaimer is that I'm just a messenger today trying to do justice to the great work that these people have done over the past few years. There are three main topics in today's talk: when to write rules, how to write rules, and how to test rules using finite differences. So let's get started. Lyndon's talk last JuliaCon is a great introduction to automatic differentiation and the Chain Rules project. Very briefly, the main takeaways are that automatic differentiation is useful, that we have many AD systems in Julia, and that they all need rules that are efficient and correct. ChainRules project fills this niche. It provides common tangent types and utilities for defining rules in ChainRulesCore, utilities for testing rules using finite differences in ChainRulesTestUtils, as well as hundreds of rules for Julia standard libraries in ChainRules.jl. This is how these three packages interact with the rest of the ecosystem. An AD package, like Zygot, depends on ChainRulesCore to be able to use the rules and the tangent types, and on ChainRules to get access to hundreds of rules for Julia standard libraries. Other packages, such as specialfunctions.jl, only need to depend on the very lightweight ChainRulesCore package to define their custom rules. They do not need to depend on ChainRules package. To be able to test the custom rules using finite differences, special functions also has a test time dependency on ChainRules test utils. There are two kinds of rules that ChainRules provides: the frule for forwards mode AD and the rrule for backwards mode AD. The frule takes a function and its arguments and transforms the derivatives of the primal inputs to the derivatives of the primal outputs. The rrule takes a function and its arguments and returns the primal result as well as a pullback, where pullback is a function that takes the derivative of the primal output and returns the derivatives of the primal inputs. As a reminder of the notation used in this slide, x dot represents dx d something, and x bar represents d something dx. ChainRules also provides a number of tangent types. Zero tangent and no tangent both represent zero-like tangents. The difference between them is that zero tangent represent the tangent for a primal that is perturbable but happens to have no effect on the primal results, while no tangent represents that the tangent space does not exist because the primal is not perturbable, for example an index. Tangent with a capital T is a type that represents tangents of structs, tuples, named tuples and dicts, and is parameterized by the primal type. The two thunk types represent delayed computation that can potentially be avoided, and inplaceable thunk in addition can accumulate gradients in place. Now that's all great, but you might be thinking, why do I need rules at all? Isn't the point of autodiff that I don't have to work out all of these gradients by hand? It turns out that even a perfect AD system needs rules to A, work at all, meaning it needs rules for basic operations that are then combined in more complicated functions, and B, to be efficient. For example, autodiff through numerical integration would take a very long time, while applying mathematical insight from the fundamental theorem of calculus results in a very elegant and efficient rule. However, we don't actually have a perfect AD system in Julia, and imperfect AD systems need even more rules. Again, to work at all, meaning the rule works around unsupported features, and B, to be more efficient, meaning that a rule can work around a function that would be very slow to autodiff through otherwise. Here are a few examples for Zygot AD. Zygot does not support mutation and cannot differentiate through functions that mutate arrays internally. However, if no arguments are mutated, it is possible to write a rule instead. Similarly, Zygot does not support differentiating through try and catch statements. Again, writing a rule will solve this issue. There are some language features that Zygot can differentiate through, but it is quite slow. The canonical examples are differentiating through loops and in-place accumulation, though the latter has recently been improved. Both of these would benefit from having rules written. Now that we have determined when it is appropriate to write rules, let's take a look at how to write rules by going through a basic example. Let's look at a primal program that is just a matrix multiplication, but for illustration purposes, we include a custom struct foo with two fields, matrix A and a float C. The function that we will write the rule for is foo mul, and it multiplies the matrix field A with some other array B. The C field is not involved and has no effect on the output. To add a method for the rrule, we have to import it from ChainRulesCore. Just to remind you of the signature, the rrule dispatches on the type of the function and the arguments of the function, and returns the primal result as well as a pullback. I would also like to point out that it is possible to change the primal computation. We might want to do that for efficiency reasons, for example when work is shared between the primal and the pullback, such as computing the inverse of some matrix. The signature of the pullback is that it takes the derivative of the primal output and returns the derivatives of the primal inputs. Now, let's examine all the tangents individually. The tangent for foo mul function is no tangent because it is not possible to perturb a function. On the other hand, functors or callable structs can have fields and would have a different tangent. Tangent of the struct foo is a capital T tangent, parametrized by the primal type foo, and we specify the tangents of each of the fields individually. The tangent of the C field is a zero tangent because C has no effect on the primal output. We could have also not specified the tangent of C explicitly because all the non-specified tangent fields are implicitly zero tangents. And finally, let me point out that A and B tangents would be a good place to use an implaceable tunk to delay and potentially avoid the computation of the tangent and to accumulate gradients in place. Having worked through a basic example, let's now examine some gotchas and helper macros which define frules and rrules automatically. There are three things we can do with structs: pass them as arguments to a function, make them callable, or create an instance. The rules for each of these have different signatures. We have already seen using lowercase typeof to dispatch on a function, followed by the arguments of the function. The rrule for a callable object has only the object and the arguments in the signature. Finally, the rrule for a constructor is the trickiest case. Capital T type foo must be used. If lowercase typeof foo is used, the rrule is defined for all constructors. The reason is that lowercase type of foo is a data type. So take care when writing rules for constructors. At not implemented macro can be used in case a function has multiple inputs or outputs for those tangents that have not been worked out analytically. There are two advantages of using this macro over a dummy value or throwing an error. The first one is that it plays nicely with chain rules test utils. And the second one is that an informative stack trace is thrown if something attempts to use the dummy value. At non-differentiable macro can be used to automatically generate both the frule and the rrule if all the arguments of the function are non-perturbable. An example of usage is shown for join path function, which only takes strings as arguments. At scalar rule macro can be used to automatically generate both the frule and the rrule for functions that only have scalar arguments. Scalar here means a subtype of number, but there can be more than a single argument. Now it's time to dive into two more advanced concepts, rule config and the array dilemma. Let's start with the rule config. Rule config is a way to make rules conditionally defined depending on the properties of the AD system. This allows us to define a rule which calls forward mode AD inside the rule definition. This rule will only be used by AD systems which support forward mode. AD systems which do not support forward mode will not see this rule. The way this is implemented is with a trait-like system. AD systems declare their properties by creating a custom struct, myAdRuleConfig, with subtypes a RuleConfig parameterized by a union of features that characterize the AD system. The rule authors can then specify the properties of the AD system that are needed for the rule to be defined. For example, an rrule that is only defined for AD systems with feature 1 would have as its first argument a rule config parameterized by a supertype of feature 1, for example, a union of types which includes feature 1. An frule that is only defined for ADs with both feature 1 and feature 2 would have its first argument a rule config parameterized by a union of the two features. This allows us to call back into AD via the following mechanism. First, an AD system has to specify the support for or lack of support for both the forwards and reverse mode via its rule config subtype. Secondly, depending on which mode it supports, it has to define rrule via AD or frule via AD, which are functions that use autodef to compute derivatives and package them in the same way that the rule would. Having access to AD inside the rrule allows us to write rules for higher order functions, such as mapping an arbitrary function over an array. To restrict the usage of this rule to only the AD systems that support forwards mode, hasForwards mode feature is specified in the rule config argument. The rest of the arguments are as in a normal rule: type of map, the function we are providing the rule for, followed by its arguments. Inside the rrule, we can then use frule via AD, which behaves like an rrule for arbitrary functions. Writing rules for your own AD system is also easy. There is no need to define a new feature. All you have to do is dispatch on the rule config itself. Next up is the array dilemma. More formally, the array dilemma is about taking the types that represent embedded subspaces a bit more seriously. Just a warning, I do find this issue quite complicated and will struggle to explain it well in just a few minutes. So if you don't understand, it's my fault. And by the way, if you are already dozing off, this is guaranteed to put you to sleep. But don't worry, I will make sure to wake you up when we move on to the next topic. Let's consider a simple example, summing the elements of an array. The fallback implementation for an abstract array simply loops through all the elements and adds them together. Julia allows us to dispatch this function on more specific types. For a diagonal matrix, we know that we just have to sum the elements on the diagonal because all of the off-diagonal elements are zero. This specialization allows us to be more efficient. So far, so good. Let's now examine a pullback for a dense matrix, which uses the fallback primal method. The pullback is simply a dense matrix, the size of the original matrix A filled with Y bar. All of this is still non-controversial. The contentious part is the pullback for a diagonal matrix, which uses the specialized primal method. The naive solution is to define a custom rule. However, this means we have to define a custom rule for each primal method. We also have to add new rules whenever new types are added. Clearly, this is not a scalable solution. Therefore, the problem we are solving is really, what do we want to happen for a diagonal matrix or any other type that uses a specialized primal method when no specialized rrule is defined? Option 1 is to write abstractly typed rules and fall back to those, similarly to what happens in the primal pass. Option 2, on the other hand, is to let AD have a go at differentiating the specialized primal method. Both of these options have weaknesses. Option 1 can return an incorrect answer. In our example, the fallback pullback implementation would return a dense matrix as a tangent for a diagonal matrix. The other weakness of option 1 is that it could be slower than option 2. A major weakness of option 2, on the other hand, is that AD can error if the specialized primal method uses unsupported features. Another weakness is that it could be slower than option 1 in case the primal computation uses language features that the AD is inefficient at differentiating. We have decided to choose option 1, meaning to write abstractly typed fallback rrules and solve the two issues that arise. To fix the two problems, we introduce two new pieces of functionality, ProjectTo and addNoRrule macro. ProjectTo solved the first problem by projecting the tangent onto the right tangent type for the primal. addNoRrule macro allows us to easily opt out of using the fallback rrule for a specific function signature and use AD instead. Let's look at each of the solutions in more detail. We solved the first problem by making sure that the tangent remains in the subspace of the primal. This is done in two steps. First, we create an object that knows how to project on the right tangent type. In our example, it would know it has to project on the diagonal type, and it would also know the size of the diagonal. Secondly, we project the tangent onto the right type. In our example, we would project a dense matrix onto a diagonal matrix. In the rrule, the first step is done outside the pullback to avoid closing over the whole matrix. The projection itself is done inside the pullback. The second problem is that the fallback rrule can be slower than AD through the specialized primal method. We solve this by providing addNoRrule macro. It opts out of using the fallback rrule for the specified function signature. This allows us to quickly check whether AD or the fallback rrule is faster. Right, so we are now past the difficult stuff, and it's time to move on to testing rules with finite differencing methods. You really need to test your rules using finite differencing. The reason is that any misunderstanding you have had when writing the rule could also creep into your tests and deceive you into thinking that your rule is correct. ChainRulesTestUtils provides two functions, testFrule and testRrule, which make finite differencing testing really easy. As you can see, the syntax is very simple. This simple syntax is powered by automatic tangent generation. It is also possible, and indeed sometimes necessary, to specify the tangents explicitly. The tangents can be specified for some or all of the arguments, and the output tangent can also be specified manually. Finally, it is also possible to test gradients computed by AD systems. This can be done by passing in an rrule-like function as a keyword argument. And if you remember the rrule via AD function from the RuleConfig story, that very same function can be used here as well. Having looked at when to write rules, how to write rules, and how to test rules, it's now time to wrap up. ChainRules 1.0 is out, and I included the fingers crossed emoji because at the time of making this talk, ChainRules 1.0 is very much not out, but we plan to release it by the time you get to hear this talk. In any case, a number of new features have been added to ChainRules since last year. They range from solving the bigger issues like calling back into AD and the array dilemma, to quality of life improvements, such as convenient macros for writing rules and improved testing. ChainRules is now also integrated into a number of AD systems, and there are plans to get others involved as well. Finally, there are hundreds of rules written by a dedicated community, making your models train and train faster. Looking into the future, here's a list of things on our wish list for future releases. We would like to support higher order rules and rules for mutating functions. We would also like to have better solutions for the array dilemma and in-place accumulation. And because we're greedy, there are also more things on the list. It would be great if you get involved and help us implement some of these. So, to summarize, ChainRules 1.0 is out, and there are a few reasons to celebrate. ChainRules is integrated in many AD systems. It has hundreds of correct and efficient rules, and it provides utilities to easily write even more rules and test them using finite differences. I hope you found the talk useful and that you enjoy the rest of JuliaCon. Thank you.